Hey, listen, a couple things about Christianarchy. Our websites have all been redone by Michael over in Sweden, and you got to check them out. In fact, I think we're going to show them to you. There's, if you just go to www.hotm.tv, and you can access Christianarchy Today. You can access campuschurch.tv, our website, and you can access 500 hours of talking about Mormon stuff. You can reach HOTM 2.0, which is another show we do, and a bunch of other stuff. In fact, we have a new book out that we hope you guys will check out because it's free to you. You can download it, you can download the PDF, or you can have the ebook automatically sent to your computer. It's called The Christian Anarchist Crookbook, Volume 1. And covers topics A through M. Volume 2 will be out in late 2018. And we hope that you'll check that out because it gives you the reasonable view of everything A through M in Volume 1. And if you don't realize it, it's a play off the 1960s, 70s book that is called The Anarchist Cookbook. And that is a book that gave you all the ways to build bombs and things. This is to expose religious crooks. And so we hope you'll download it and take your time to read it because I think it's worthwhile. We're going to share with you tonight, it's going to be a short show, what I think is the single most important passage in the entire New Testament, if not the Bible, because it tells us so much in this one little passage that we just overlook when we read it. We don't think about it. It's not about Jesus. It's not about the apostles. It's not about the gospel. All those things are the general picture that are so important to the Bible. But this is a passage that helps us know how to place the contents of the Bible. Let's just say that there is an inspired guy, and God told him to write some instructions, and in the instructions he said, listen, God loves you, he cares about you, talk to God, and in the spring, thatch the base of your house with mud to protect it from the coming storms. All right, so we would get that inspired writing. We'd read it today, and there are people who would read, patch around the base of your house with mud because it will protect you from the waters of the storm. They will take that and they'll make it literal, and they'll actually command that everybody do it, or they'll come up with some significant reason why we have to use that in our lives, when in reality, the most important point is God loves you. He wants you to talk to him, etc., etc. So how do you know what is to us and what isn't to us? How can we tell in the Bible? We've been talking about that every week. Well, I'm going to get to that most important passage, and it's in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. All right, and I'm just going to, the first 10 verses are Paul, and what he's doing is he is talking about the children of Israel. And he says, listen, brethren, we had our forefathers, and they walked around in the desert under a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And he goes on and he says, and they were baptized in the Red Sea, and they did eat food in the wilderness, and they did drink, and they followed the rock, and he says all kinds of things in the first verses. And he says, but not everybody was God pleased with in that group that was wandering around in the wilderness. Not everybody was God pleased. And he says, and those things that happened to them became types for us. And what he means by that is when something happened to them in the Old Testament, it became an example for the people in Paul's day. For instance, the children of Israel got thirsty. And they needed water. So Moses was told by God, go and strike the rock. And when you strike the rock, water will flow out of it and give everybody water. So Moses goes and he strikes a rock and water flows out. Well, the example that gave to Paul and all his followers in that day was through Christ, the water flows and you will drink and never be thirsty again. It was an Old Testament story that gave an illustration and an example for the New Testament people. So he goes on, he says, all these things, we shouldn't commit whoredoms, he says. Children of Israel committed whoredoms. That's an example or a story for us. We shouldn't do it. And he says that we shouldn't tempt Christ and we shouldn't murmur. This is all going on through that. And then he comes to the most important passage in the Bible. Now, all I want you to do is read this in what's called Young's Literal Translation. I'm going to read it to you from Young's Literal Translation. Why is that important? What Young did is he went through and he took every Greek word in the order that they came in the manuscripts, and he translated them to English comparable words consistently. So he didn't take a Greek word and sometimes say it meant dog, and a Greek word, and the same Greek word, and say sometimes it meant animal, and a Greek word, same Greek word, and say sometimes it meant rabbit. He took the same Greek words and translated them literally into the English word all the way through his translation of the Bible. And he did it in the order, so it's not really easy to read. He didn't mix it up for us so that we could, you know, have a real easy to read version. But what I'm going to read to you is pretty easy, and it will tell you why this is an important passage. So Paul has said all this stuff happened in the Old Testament with our forefathers. And then at verse 11 he says, and all these things are types, remember they're examples, did happen to those persons back then, Old Testament, and they were written for our, Paul and his church at that time, the people in the church there, they were written for our admonition. They were written for our advice. They were written so that we could learn from it. That's why they were written. So we could read that Old Testament and see principles in it. Listen, he adds, to whom the end of the ages did come. He says, so these things are types that happened to those persons, and they were written for our admonition at that time in the New Testament, 2,000 years ago, our admonition to whom, meaning our, to whom did the end of the ages come? So what he is telling us there, straight from the Greek, is that, listen, the Old Testament stories were written for the New Testament church at that time during Paul's age. And they were written for their admonition, their learning, their lessons. Upon whom, meaning our, those people, then not us, upon them did the end of everything come. Meaning the wiping out of everything religious came upon them. When? It happened in 70 AD. That's when all the stuff that we read about in this book occurred. And it was all fulfilled. Everything in it was fulfilled. So it was an inspired book, and it talked about things then that were real. Hell, the covered place, and punishment that was coming happened, and the wiping out of that age. But it talks about the end of that age coming. All of it is included here. And when it is finished, the last book of Revelation, all of it's done and fulfilled. Done. You put it down. Then we go back to that example of, so when we open it up and read, how do we know what applies to us and how do we know what doesn't? Well, we know that anything that has to do with that age, those times, how to do church, how to have church discipline, how to take care of widows, all that is all done. It's material church done. The spiritual principles remain here, loving each other, seeking after God, having faith in God, trusting in Christ, those things. And so you can easily then read this book individually, see what it says to you in your heart. You don't need somebody else to interpret it for you. You can read it and you can understand. You can learn from other people, but it doesn't mean that they're right. Doesn't mean I'm right. You just read it and it has spiritual lessons for you, and then you go on. Unfortunately, that key passage, 1 Corinthians 10:11, is ignored by people, and they actually think that patching the mud with the house with the mud verses in this book are still applicable. And they are not. It's taking the name of God in vain, really. It's using God and his plan that is obvious in this thing by preterists and fulfillment people. It's taking his plan and it's ignoring it. and say, no, 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 we need to bring everything back and keep it going with us today and keep doing it for 2,000 years after it's all been fulfilled. Keep playing church. Keep trying to keep the church going with all this stuff. Keep collecting the money. Keep doing the rules. Keep having church discipline on the homosexuals and cast the whores out and do all the things that Paul and the early church did then under the auspices of that time, because that's what we're supposed to do, and it makes absolutely no sense as proven by the Bible itself. Check out HOTM.TV, all the new websites. Download or ask for a PDF of the new book, the Christian Anarchist Crookbook, and we'll see you later. Out.